Okay, if there's only one lesson that you watch in this class, it's gotta be this one. And don't get me wrong, the other ones are fantastic, they're super creative, but this one, well, it's a built-in feature that a whopping 98% of Storyline users tend to either overlook or don't even know about in the drag and drops. And I'm talking about here the drop correct and drop incorrect states. These are built-in states that are designed to provide visual feedback for your learners, and it's all automatic. You don't need any triggers or anything else. It's all built in. So let me go show ahead and show you how that works. Okay, so I'm starting here in the welcome screen. And you know what I'm gonna do real quick? Before we build this, I'm gonna import a PowerPoint. Thought about doing that. It's one of the best ways to quickly kickstart your projects if you have the graphics already set up in a PowerPoint file. So I have that here. So I'm just gonna import a PowerPoint file, and I've got that here on my project file. So I'll bring this in. What Storyline's gonna do is look at all of the slides. It's only a single slide for me, but it's gonna look at all the slides, all the information, the text, the designs, so it's templates, placeholders, colors, and fonts. And it's gonna bring that all in for my project. So you can see I have one project file right here, and I'll keep that in the current scene that we're in. Well, we don't really have a scene yet, so this one, it's not gonna matter. But what's nice is all of the graphics will be editable. Editable, not edible, and I can bring those in and then work from those directly in Storyline. So that's going to be a big help for getting this started. So give me a second here, or give Storyline a second here to bring this in. Okay, and so here's our project file. It's already set up. If I double click the slide to look at it, you can see I've got everything already here. I've got my objects, I've got my drop notes, targets. And so I can change the text on all of these. Looks a little small here. Sometimes that happens because PowerPoint being a print-based application might make it just a little bit larger. And what are my default themes? Calibri, right? And this is just text right there. And I can also change the colors. If I look at the format tab, you can see the fill. There we go, right? And we know that this is tied to our design colors, our theme colors, because I can see the little red outline right here on accent 4, indicating that this is indeed a part of the current theme. So if I didn't see anything highlighted, then I would know that that color had been hard-coded or just picked with the eyedropper and locked in. But I can change that by going to the design tab, and then I can come over to colors, and then I can just start moving these around, and notice how all the colors are updating. Doesn't mean they're always gonna be right, but it means that these are editable, and with a single click, I can make those changes. All right, so what I'm gonna do real quick just to make this set up is I'm going to label these items real quick. So this is a trash can, so this is a drop target, it's drop, and I'll call it trash, and the next one would be drop keep file cabinet, right? So it's a sorting activity. So we'll set this up, and these are my drag objects here. So here's what I can do real quick. I'm just gonna say drag dash zero, and I'm gonna hit return. So what I want is, I want this, let me just make sure I can see that. I just want that prefix, because once I copy that, copy, then I can come into each one of these quickly and just add a one. Next one I can double click and add a paste, and then a two, and then double click, and then a three. So it's a fast way to rename each of these objects without having to type it out each time, because sometimes typing and talking is tough. So I think that's all set up. I don't need my instructions, and the rest of that looks really good. All right, and let's just save this real quick. So Control S just to save, and I'll save it to the desktop to make that easier. So drag and drop sorting, and this would be our states. Okay, so we have our file set up. Let's go ahead and convert this to a drag and drop interaction. We do that from coming up here to the insert tab, and we just want to get that in, whoa, what happened there? Insert tab, and convert to freeform. So the very first, second option right here. And so we're going to choose drag and drop. The Storyline's going to convert this to a custom drag and drop interaction for us that we can then really use any custom layout that we like. So quickly, I'm just going to select all of my drag items, and because I added that prefix there for the drag, makes it really easy to find each of these. So I'm just gonna go through here, drag one, two, three, and so on, right? Just to knock them out. And then what we can say is, let's just say the first three will be the drag keep, and then the last three, the second batch, will be the drag trash. So the first ones will be keep, and I'm just obviously randomizing that. So one, two, and three will be objects that go onto the file cabinet, and then four, five, and six will go to the trash. All right, and with that, I'm going to click back to my slide, and you can see Storyline automatically set up some incorrect feedback for us. Okay, so at this point, we're ready to take a look at the interaction, and then we'll look at our first tip, and that is to customize those feedback states for the drag, the drop correct, and drop incorrect. So let's just take a look and see how this looks. But super fast, right? How fast we can put this together from a drag and drop interaction. So now these objects are all draggable. I can drop them on each of the targets. And of course, the stacking right here, the way these are stacked can all be customized. Click submit, and then there's my feedback. All right. So let's look at this tip. This is one of the most missed areas in working with states, especially drag and drops. And that is we can provide visual feedback to the learner to let them know before they click submit how they did on their interaction. So if you look at this first object, the note one, I'm going to come down here to the states panel and we'll pop that open. So we just have the normal state. So what I want to do is add two states to show how the object is dropped, whether it's on a correct target or the incorrect target. So we're going to use some visual feedback for that to help indicate. So I'm going to click edit states and we'll add a new state and we're going to choose a built-in. So we're not going to give it a custom name, right? We're not going to create our own state. We're just going to come down here and we'll choose the drop correct and drop incorrect. So what these will do is when the object is dropped on either a correct or incorrect target, the object can change its appearance. That's what states are for, right? Controlling how that object looks. So we'll say drop correct, add, and then we'll just make that simple. Let's see here, drop correct, we'll say that's a green. And then for drop incorrect, so second state, this time we're gonna use the incorrect, click add, and then we'll just use the red. All right, I'm just gonna say this real quick. I'm just using color right here to indicate the feedback. Color alone typically is not recommended for accessibility concerns, right? So you want to have more than just color alone. We could add a different text. We could change the text. We could add icons, something else in here to make this more visible because the color alone may not be enough for some learners. But I'm just going to use that for the purpose of the demo. But I just wanted to keep that in mind real quick. All right, so click done. And then to speed up our process, I'm going to use the format painter to quickly apply those changes. So home, and I'm going to double click the format painter. So by double clicking this, it's going to remain persistent, meaning that I can apply those properties from this first object to multiple objects. So click, look at that, note two, note three, note six, five, and four. All right, so they all have those states. That was super quick. I'm just going to click away to deselect. Okay. And so everything still looks the same here, but we have these new states here to show how it's going to work. So if I preview this, this is your little internal test right here. Is this going to work? Will we see those states? So if you know how this is going to work right now, then you already know most of this tip. If you don't, then here's how it works. I drop it on. Hey, wait a minute. Where is that visual feedback? I thought we were supposed to help the learner get to the correct answer. Well, the way it's set up by default is when I press or click tap submit, now we'll see those color changes. But the way this feedback slide is appearing with that faded background, it's kind of hard to tell. We're kind of covering it up with the feedback modal. Instead, what we want to do is provide learners that guidance or that hint up front so they can consider their choices and then decide if they want to move on. So I'm going to go in here, and what am I going to do? I am going to go to my design tab for the question tools, so up here on the ribbon, and then over here under drag and drop options, this is where we can control how and when that feedback is applied. So look down here at the very bottom. Here's what we have, feedback, delay item drop states until interaction is submitted. We're just going to turn that off, and we'll click OK. Okay, so now when we preview, we'll see each of those change. So we drop one on, there's the red, drop it on over there, and there's the green. And so, you know, we're not trying to trick our learner all the time. We're just trying to help them get to that correct answer, right? If they move it back and forth, they can see the red and say, okay, maybe I need to come there, and so on. So it's just a way to provide that feedback up front to the learner to help guide them to making the correct choice rather than, you know, possibly just trying to set them up so they miss the answer or just without any assistance. All right, so a couple things though, real quick, just because it's worth mentioning this as well. I notice over here in the slide triggers, probably should have said this when we first imported that PowerPoint, and that is when you import PowerPoints, typically the way the triggers or actions are set up in PowerPoint is to jump to the next slide when the slide ends. So you don't want your slide doing this. So when the timeline ends on this slide, jump to the next slide. I'm going to delete that trigger. You don't need that because we're submitting the interaction. So just look for those when you import your PowerPoint files. And then finally, we also can change how these objects are dropped on each of the targets. So that comes up a lot. So if I right click this object right here, we can see that there's a drag and drop option. And then there's the option for snap to center or free and how all of these objects work. So we can change these objects like this by selecting them to free and also do the same one. So what does that mean right here then? It means that when the object is dropped on a target, it can just touch a part of that target. It doesn't have to be in that center part of the object. So you can see now it's off to the side. And as long as part of it's touching, right, then it's going to work. So you can see there's that little corner right there. That's part of it. So that's another option you have for working with those targets. Lastly, what happens if the object gets dropped back up top? So this is going to be just a little bit of a bonus tip. I like to show this as well. It's not totally part of the state changes, but if you have the object, say, returning back to the top or the learner moves them off to the side away from a target, it's indicating that they're correct, but the learner may know that, right? If they're resetting these objects back up here or they just nudge one of them, they all look like they're incorrect. So here's a workaround around that. And again, maybe this doesn't apply to the way you're working with drag and drops, but I've seen this happen before, so I think it's worth just mentioning it. Let's do a quick save here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring in a hotspot. I love the hotspot. Just a hotspot is this big invisible button that you can use. No, not an input, a hotspot. So I'll use the rectangle hotspot, and I'm just going to drag this big hotspot all over here across the top area. And I'm just going to call this one hotspot reset. And so what I want to do is reset that objects that are dropped or removed back up here to this top area. So I'm going to bring this all the way to the bottom just so it's out of the way. And one thing you have to do with hotspots is if I right click this hotspot, notice how it says show the hand cursor. So I want to disable that. I don't want to show that hand cursor when they mouse over. So actually, I'll just preview that real quick. So what the hand cursor is going to do is just going to show that it's an active button. So it thinks that maybe you want to click on top of it. Did I move it below things? Or did I already take it off? Let me preview that one more time. So I didn't see the hand cursor, but I would expect to have seen it. Interesting. It's not showing. So maybe there is something going on. But what I'm going to do still is delete that or deselect that. So don't show that hand on hover. And so what I want to do is just reset these back to the normal state whenever the objects are dropped on this hotspot. So here's how this looks. We'll say a new trigger. And so what is it we want to do? And when do we want to do it? We want to change the state of, we'll say this first note card. So we'll say change the state of drag one. And you can see, again, just to reinforce this, the benefit of using that common prefix when you're working with similar objects. So these are all of my drag objects, and I have my two drop keeps together. So change the drag one to normal, and then we'll say when the object is dropped on that hotspot. So we'll say object is dropped on, and the object being the drag one is dropped on a hotspot reset. So that should reset it. We'll click OK. And what's nice here is that we can select this trigger and then choose copy trigger. So we have that option to copy what we just added. So we'll say copy it. And then I'm going to shift click these remaining five objects to multi-select them so they're all selected together. Head back over to my triggers, and then I can just press the paste those triggers right there. So that's going to add that same trigger for each of them, and it also applies to each of the individual cards. So it's changing drag three, it's changing drag six. All right, let's preview this one more time and see how this looks. So here's my note. If I move it around, okay, so last thing I need to change is it's now centering everything in here on the hotspot, because the hotspot also has its own drag properties as well. So it didn't change the card, but I do need to right click this hotspot, and I'm going to choose now drag and drop. and I'm going to say free. So snapping everything directly to the center, say free, and now we move it up. And so I like walking through these steps. I've done this a bunch, but I like how each fix sort of sometimes introduces a new issue, and it's an issue only because of how each of these properties works. So the more we can, you know our tools, the more we can work with them, the better we're going to be, and we'll be able to kind of adjust to these different workarounds. But here we have it, right? So we're dropping these targets right here on that hotspot, and it's keeping these all set to the normal. And then, of course, when I start to bring them down here, I can get that feedback and see how that looks. But if I bring them back, it resets everything to the normal. So if I were to submit the interaction, right, it's still going to be incorrect, but it doesn't show me that visual feedback that says, yeah, this is incorrect. Because in a sense, you're not really placing them here. You know that the targets are down here on the bottom. And there you have it, my friends, plain and simple. Just a quick reminder, though, if you want that feedback to be instantaneous, make sure to uncheck that delay feedback option. Oh, and here's a pro tip. When you're using colors to signal correct or incorrect, be sure to throw in some extra visual cues like text labels, icons, patterns, shapes. It's just not about looking good visually, but you also want to ensure accessibility for all of your learners. And in today's world, that's more crucial than ever. All right, I hope you found this tip super helpful and see how it'll be hopefully a great addition to your e-learning bag of tricks the next time you're working with Storyline's drag and drop interactions.